Just as in praying today for this, I just feel like we need to pray. And so I want to start just a little bit of review because I want everybody to be on the same page. So the first thing we talked about was praying things out. Now, when I talk about praying things out, I'm mostly talking about praying in the Holy Ghost, praying in other tongues. And so I'm just going to assume everybody in the room, it's a Wednesday night. I'm going to assume everybody in the room is filled with the Holy Ghost. If you're not filled with the Holy Ghost, with the evidence speaking other tongues, we got a couple right here on the front row that get you filled in about 2 minutes. And so you can see them afterwards or come get them in the middle if you want while we're praying. Not right now, but in the middle. And Nadra and Ollie, you can do it. Like, right, just that. They're ready. I mean, we got a bunch trained. And so we can help you get filled, and you need to be. You need to be, because the Lord said praying things out is no longer a luxury, it's a necessity. And so we live in a time where we need to know the future. And so one of the things we talked about in 1 Corinthians 14, verse number 2, it says that we pray in the Holy Ghost, we pray out of mysteries. One of the things about the future is it is a mystery. You don't know. And the only thing that you and I have is we can look around at things based on our circumstances and make a good judgment. And, you know, I look around the room and you all look pretty intelligent, pretty smart, and you can make a good judgment. But even your best judgment, if you had the opportunity to hear from heaven, and he gave you this promise in John 16, 13, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he'll guide you into all truth, not speak of himself, but he will show, that word show is declare, disclose, and transmit future things to you. So you can know what's coming in the future. You don't even have to have the gifts or the manifestations of the Spirit. The word of wisdom is about future things. So you don't even need a manifestation of the Spirit to know the future. It's part of your rights and privileges as sons and daughters of the Lord. And so we were talking about praying things out. So it comes, we're talking about praying in the Spirit. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, I believe it's about verse 13, not exactly sure, but it talks about that if you pray in an unknown tongue, pray that you would interpret. And then it goes on to say, I will pray in the Spirit, and I will pray in the understanding also. I will sing in the Spirit, and I will sing in the understanding also. So you know in Acts chapter number 2, where they all got filled with the Holy Ghost, they heard them praising them in their own language, praying the wonderful works of God. So we know that God can do many things with language. But what I do want you to know, because sometimes people think, well, that's just stuff like that. Well, when it talks about praying in this, I will pray in the Spirit, and I'll pray in the understanding, it's talking about praying in other tongues, and then it's talking about praying in your understanding by the unction of the Holy Ghost, the same place you just got done praying in tongues. In other words, it's not talk, I will sing in the Spirit, and I will sing in the understanding. It's not talking about, I was hooked up here, now I'm going to disconnect and get up here. Because you can, and you need to learn how to pray the Word, and you can pray that with your understanding. And it's effective and effectual. But we're talking about when you're praying in the Spirit, because then you can get into a place, what I'm talking about, how to pray things out, is you're praying in the Holy Ghost, and you have faith that as the Spirit of God gives, you're not forcing, you're not pretending, you're not hoping, but it's still hooked in, and then it turns into a known language that you can understand, English, if you speak some Spanish. I know... for me, every once in a while, when I'm in a Spanish-speaking country, that'll be a little more there sometimes. I know some Spanish words, very few, but I do. And so you can sing in the Spirit. Now, I will say that maybe I had an advantage over people because of the way I got filled with the Holy Ghost. I told you this story. When I first came into this, my sister drugged me to this kind of church, and I didn't understand it. Some woman preacher, didn't know women weren't supposed to be preaching back then, and a woman preacher was up. They still are okay. And so she double dog dared me to cross some line. I went up in front. You know, I was telling you, I was going through my urban cowboy phase. I had my cowboy boots on, my turquoise belt buckle. I left my hat at home, and you know, looking really good. And I shook in my boots for 45 minutes. And I remember doing some TTTT. There was no jam and bread. It was just TTT, and nobody was there to help. They didn't really understand that much. And then, though, I heard other people speak in tongues. And so I asked, you know, I wanted to, all the only way I knew how to pray was, Lord, I want to pray like them. They seemed to get it to a place, because I remember when I would worship God and I'd tell him he's awesome and you're amazing and you're excellent and you're glorious and you're powerful. It was never enough for me. There's more words that I could describe who you really are if I could just do what they do. I want to do what they do. And when I got filled with the Holy Ghost, what happened was we were singing. We were worshiping, and my tongue changed from English to other tongues while I was singing. So kind of for me, because that was my familiar place, I just began to do that because I didn't have a lot of teaching. I went to church with a lot of zeal. There was a whole lot of zeal where I went to church, not much wisdom. And so I kind of was finding my way on my own until my Aquila Priscilla, Margaret, her name was, kind of helped me along the way. But because I was comfortable with singing in the Spirit, because that's how I got filled, I did a lot of it. Because that was my happy place. That was my familiar place. Because it happened that way, that was my faith place. And so when I began to do that, and then I just read in 1 Corinthians 14. I know we're spending a lot of time reviewing. Oh my, we can't get stuck here. I got a lot to do. So I read, I will sing in the Spirit and I will sing in the understanding. I will pray. So I just said to the Lord, and I told you this story, but I want to increase your faith tonight because I want you to know you can do this too, and you need to do this. I don't want something made up. I want something real, but faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. If you are filled with the Holy Ghost and you pray in other tongues, you can have this in your life, and you need this. And you need this. And so I just went behind the barn. My mom and dad lived on a farm. That's where I grew up. And so I went to the barn. Bad things can happen in a barn, but this time good things happened in the barn. And if you grew up in the country, you understand that. But I went behind the barn. I said, okay, Lord, I'm going to do this. I'm going to sing in tongues. And it's an unknown song because that's what I did a lot of. And yet this time when I get done, it's going to turn into English because you said. And so this is what I did. So I looked up to heaven. And I said, here I go, and I expect you to do this. He said, well, see, I didn't know any better not to talk to God that way. He said it, and I'm going to do it. So I did, and he did. And I've been doing it ever since. And even, you know, maybe if you've seen me be used publicly, that started some 30-odd years ago privately behind a barn. And God won't be able to use you publicly till you get proficient privately. Because the Bible says, speak to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And then later in Colossians, it says, speak to one another. So you got to get good at speaking to yourself before you can speak to one another. And it's a very cool way to speak to one another. Because everybody knows it's not you. It's God. Because see, y'all, I can't rhyme to save my life. I remember when I was a senior in high school and I had this writing class. And one of our assignments was to write a story that was full of rhyme. And then my teacher would read it in front of everybody else. And, you know, I was a pretty good student. But mine was so bad, and I was so embarrassed, and they all laughed at me. And I don't try to do the rhyme thing. So I think it's very funny today when the Lord does that, because I personally can't rhyme. So when that comes up out of me, that is all Holy Ghost. And when I try to do it in the natural, it is really, really bad. It's like when I try to be funny. It's really bad. But when I'm just funny, I'm funny. And then, you know, you think, oh, I did that. Let's try this. And it just never works. I'm telling you, the Holy Ghost, that's what I'm talking about, is things become of the Spirit. And so if you can pray in other tongues, you can pray in the Spirit and pray out of your spirit in the understanding also. I want you to have faith for it. There's things in your future. There's mysteries that must be solved. There's things in your future. There's mysteries that must be solved. There's relationships that you need to know about. There's career choices you need to know about. There's houses or cars or things you need to buy that you need to know about. There are things that are just as natural, but if all you and I do is live as mere men and just make judgment calls, we have no other advantage. We're just like the world, but you and I are not like the world. We are sons and daughters of the Most High God, and we have an advantage, and we need to use it. We have the Holy Ghost on the inside of us, who's given us the ability to pray things out. And so while we're praying things out, we looked at watch and pray. Watching in the Spirit and praying. The Bible tells us over and over again in the New Testament to watch and pray. So when you pray in the Holy Ghost, you are watching and praying. You're like happens in Isaiah. You're up on a fence, so to speak, in the realm of the Spirit. You're looking out at things that are good or bad that are coming your direction, and you can be aware of them. That has saved our lives physically and some other things by being watchers, learning how to watch. Everybody say, I'm going to watch and pray. See, there is a prayer that is the prayer of faith that when you need something from God, you do what Mark 11, 23 and 24 says. Whatsoever things you desire when you pray, believe you receive them, you should have them. You do what 1 John 5, 14, 15 says. This is the confidence that I have in him. If I ask anything according to his will, I know that he hears me. If I know he hears me, I know that I have him. That's the prayer petition. And you need to be very good at that. And we've taught you how to do that. But there's more than one kind of praying. There's more than one. And if that's the prayer of faith is the only prayer you pray, you can learn to receive, but then you're always living in the right now. And if the prayer of faith is the only prayer you know how to pray, you're always in some ways, kind of in catch-up mode, because the prayer of faith results in something, because you need something. But this kind of praying will get you out living in the future. And it'll help you when you come up to something, you'll know what to do. You'll know what not to do. You'll know what decision to make and what decision not to make. And so it's really important and it's really exciting, but you're a watcher. And you can learn to watch in the Spirit. Romans chapter 8 talks about the prayer of intercession. Now, that prayer of intercession, it's talking about where the Spirit of God, it says itself, but really himself is better, Romans 8, 26. Talk about the Spirit of God coming on you and praying through you, making intercession. And it talks about Jesus, your high priest, is ever living to make intercession for you. So you can also see that sometimes you don't know what to pray for because you don't know. So if you don't know what to pray for, if you go right above that, remember we looked at, it's talking about hope. And what is hope? It's a joyful, confident expectation. But it means it's, and it goes on to say, but hope is not hope if you've already got it. So what's that talking about? Something out in the future that you're believing for, that you're expecting. Hope is not a dirty word. Hope lives. It's not a dirty word, right? We're expecting something. And then it says, even though we're expecting this in the future, then it goes, and it goes likewise. Likewise. I was just talking to you about the future. You're expecting likewise. Let me keep talking about the future. The Spirit, keep that up. The Spirit also helps what's our infirmity? We don't know what tomorrow is. We don't know. Can we know? For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Why? Because it's in the future. But the Spirit himself intercedes, takes hold together with against for us, and sometimes in groanings that cannot be uttered. This is even something maybe even a little deeper in tongues. And this is definitely not something you can, I'm not teaching any groaning meetings tonight. And it's not, if you ever get in one where someone's trying to teach that, you need to run. Don't stick around. Run. Nobody can teach you how to do that. It's like I can't teach you to pray in tongues. I can teach you how to yield. But those words come from the Holy Ghost. There's no who stole my Hyundai, bow tie, Shandai, kind of repeat after me kind of thing. And in the same way, it's kind of like this. You don't have to teach a woman to have a baby. I understand. Pretty much, they've been doing it for a really long time. Now, you could be there to help. When Destiny was born, I wanted to go back to the old ways. I thought waiting rooms were great. I thought that was better. But anyway, no, it was good. It was, mostly. So this is something, because like tongues, nobody taught you. Groaning, if that happens to you, yield. But it's not going to be happening on Sunday morning in the middle of a service. The Holy Ghost doesn't ever interrupt himself. That's like if I'm giving a message and someone stands up and starts giving a tongue, they're interrupting the Holy Ghost, unless I'm just not in the Holy Ghost, which I try to be all the time, but the Holy Ghost will never interrupt the Holy Ghost. Are you understanding? And so even with that, if sometimes something would come on you and you know it's the Holy Ghost, then if something like that would come on you, you would excuse yourself, because the Holy Ghost is not going to take you over and throw you down and make you groan in front of everybody if that's not what's going on. So you can excuse yourself, go take care of whatever the Lord wants you to do. And a lot of times that stuff happens more privately or in an appropriate prayer meeting setting. I have got to hurry. I haven't even got to tonight. And so the truth is, this is so big in my heart. And I've been waiting for years to try to get to the details and teach people this, because I've lived this way for so long that I've really never taught it out. I've lived it by example, especially on Wednesdays at noon when I pray, or when I'm with my staff, or with like when we go away. I've lived it in front of them, but I've really never taught this out. But I do believe that we have come into a season where you have got to know how to pray out mysteries, how to pray out the future. And how do you do that when you're praying the Holy Ghost? At the same time, you need to be led. In other words, everything is not going to always, in prayer, come out through a praying in tongues and then an interpretation or an English word or a known word. Also with that, at the same time, you're going to be working with leadings. You're going to be working with leadings. Now, prayer is so very important. Prayer is so very important. If you study the book of Acts, every time before a major move of God, every time before it was increased in the church, they were in a prayer meeting. They were in the upper room praying before the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. They prayed. Signs and wonders were done. The church increased. After the appointment of the deacons, the ministers gave themselves to prayer and the word, and the number of the disciples multiplied. And it got into the synagogues of people who had rejected Jesus. It said even the religious people began to believe. When we get to praying, one of the things the devil will try to do is keep you too busy to pray, or it's not comfortable to pray, or there's a misunderstanding about prayer. And so praying is so very relevant, so very important, and I want to talk about it so much, but let's just get to tonight what I got for you. That was a really good review. Did you enjoy that? I did, thanks. Let's just dig in. I want to remind you of some things. So let's look at James chapter 5, verse 16. In the Amplified, it says this: the earnest, heartfelt, continued prayer of a righteous man makes what? Power what? Available. Power is available. One of the things you can know, if you have a revelation of your righteousness, you know your prayers work. In other words, you won't be saying things like this: well, I prayed tonight, but I felt like there was a brass ceiling over me, or my prayers didn't go any higher than the ceiling. That's religious talk, y'all, and to get that out of your vocabulary. Because praying is not a feeling. Praying is something you do by faith. You don't have to feel nothing. Your prayers aren't hitting no ceilings. All right? When you know you're righteous. When you know you're righteous, you know what? I'm a righteous man. I've been saved, washed in the blood of Jesus. I am the righteous of God in Christ Jesus. And when I pray, there is tremendous power. It's now available. All right? Now, one of the things that we're going to get into tonight is when we're praying for other people, when we're praying for our friends, our family, when we're praying for our city, for our nation, for nations. We have assignments that God gives us in prayer. And so as people of prayer, because there's no one called to intercessor is not the sixth fold of the ministry. Everybody in this room is called to intercede. Everybody in this room is called to pray. So, you know, nobody needs to run out and get a business card that says, I'm the chief intercessor. It's not a ministry gift, all right? And so, because when that happens in the church, and it has in the past, that lets the rest of us think, well, then I don't have to do it. Somebody is called to do that. And usually it's three or four women stuck away in the back room, and that's what church, and if that's the power plant, and that's the only people praying, then that's why there's no power in the church. And the devil's very happy when there's no power in the church. But we've had power in this church, but I'm ready to amp it up a little bit. I'm ready to kick it into overdrive. Amen. So if the more people to get praying on a regular basis, and the more you understand it, the more you can pray. Because you're righteous, you make tremendous power available. Now listen, when it comes to believing God, we're a faith church. We believe, we've seen corporate prayer. We believe God for people. But I don't want you ever to misinterpret this. When it comes to you receiving your healing, when it comes to you receiving your blessings, you have to learn how to believe God for yourself. I've heard people say to me, and don't get mad at me, but you know, they say, well, I don't have faith for myself, but I have faith for everybody else. That just don't fly with me because it's not true. It's not scriptural. You can't have faith for anybody else if you don't have faith for yourself. What you're telling me is it's easier to pray for everybody else because I don't have to look at or feel what they're going through. I just know it's working. Well, you can have a spirit of prayer for someone, but listen to me. Every time you pray from that place of prayer, you're making something available. But they still have to do what? Receive it. You can't receive for everybody else. Don't we wish we could? Because wouldn't it be easier? If I'm feeling fine and I can pray from my healthy, strong place for someone who's going through pain, and it doesn't matter what's going on, if it didn't matter what they said, didn't matter what they believe, I can get it for them every time. Wouldn't that be cool? But this is not the way it works. But your prayers are effectual. And you need to keep praying for people because you make tremendous power available. And if somebody can ever hook in to what you're praying for with their faith, just makes it a lot easier for them. And that's one of the things we do as pastors, as a pastoral staff, is when we pray for people. We pray for people every Monday at our staff meetings. We're making tremendous power available. No matter what we're praying or who we're praying for, we're making that available. Now, the scripture says some other things that I want you to get. Colossians chapter 4, verse number 12, King James Version says this, Epaphras, or you could say Gloria or Fred, who is one of you, not an apostle, not a prophet, not a pastor, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, salutes you, says howdy, says hello, say what's up, y'all, always laboring fervently. So that tells me it's not just a casual, Lord bless so-and-so, Lord help so-and-so. It's fervent. It's a laboring. It's like a travail. It's getting in there, ready to birth something. Salute you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that you may stand perfect and complete in what? All the will of God. So I can pray for you. You can pray for somebody that's having trouble making decisions, or you know they're out of the will of God. You can fervently labor for them in prayer as a righteous man or woman and make a supply available for them that they'll always stand full and complete in the entire will of God. Galatians 4:19. My little children, the Apostle Paul says, my little children, of whom I travail in birth again, until Christ be formed in you. Now, how many of you know, you and I can't get anyone born again. They have to receive Jesus. But we can intercede for them so that someone will go across their path. And when they hear the glorious gospel, the blinders will come off of their eyes and they'll receive. In the same way, when praying for a saint, a backslidden one, your child, they got hit with a stupid stick, something's going on in their life, your brothers, your sisters, you know, who live, somewhere in D.C. or wherever, or they're just doing something, you can You can travail in birth for them again. They're already born again, but maybe they're not doing quite well. You can travail in birth again until what? Until Christ be formed in them. Until the anointing is formed in them. Until they mature in God. So what I'm showing you is when you and I pray, and see that word travail takes me back to Romans chapter 8. What I'm doing is I'm doing it mostly in the Holy Ghost. I'm doing it mostly in other tongues. I'm doing it mostly by help standing together with the help of the Holy Ghost. I'm working with Him. He's working with me. He's given me utterance. I'm praying things out. And sometimes when I pray things out, a scripture will rise up that I'll wrap around what I'm praying and I'll wrap around for them. And then it also sometimes gives me a confession for them when I'm not in a place of prayer, but when I think about them, a scripture will rise up that meets what I'm praying, and then it helps them, it strengthens them, and it makes tremendous power available. I'm travailing for them. I'm helping them. And Christ is being formed in them, and they're walking in the will of God. And if I can do this for somebody else, I can surely do it for me. He wouldn't ask you to do something for somebody else that this will also do it for you. And so Ephesians 6:18 says, we're praying always with all prayer and supplication. How? In the Spirit, watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. So we can pray for this, all the saints. I mean, that seems impossible, but the Spirit of God, while you're praying the Holy Ghost, you may be praying for someone you don't know. Or you may be praying for someone you do know. You can go in. It's not like every time has to be like, whatever. But you can go in, Lord, I want to pray for so-and-so. And how do you do that? Well, just for time's sake, I want you to write these down. Most of you know these and work with these. But I want to talk to you about the epistle prayers. So I want you to write these down. I'm not going to go through them. I don't have time. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 16 to 23. Ephesians chapter 1, 16 through 23. You know, it talks about the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you would know the hope of His calling. I believe when you know the hope of His calling, you'll figure out your calling. And so there's that one. And then there's Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. Ephesians 3, 14 through 21. And then you got Philippians 1, 9 through 11, which, you know, I've wore out on people, especially how they amplified. Philippians 1, 9 through 11. And then Colossians 1, because Philippians talks about, you know, that people would know what is vital. What is vital. Sometimes in people's lives, they just don't know what's vital anymore. And that they would not stumble or cause anyone else to stumble. And then you can look at Colossians 1, 9 through 11. Colossians 1, 9 through 11. And then 2 Thessalonians 1, 11 through 12. So you got Ephesians 1, 16 through 23, Ephesians 3, 14 through 21, Philippians 1, 9 through 11, Colossians 1, 9 through 11, and then 2 Thessalonians 1, 11 through 12. So those are called the epistles, the Pauline epistle prayers. If you're praying for someone, you can literally just take that scripture, put their name in it, or put your name in it, and pray it. And I would recommend that when you're praying for someone, that's a good place to jump off. Because one of the things praying in the Holy Ghost and praying in the Word does is it takes you out of the way. Have you ever noticed you get in the way? I know y'all would admit to it, but sometimes we think we're as smart as God. And when we know somebody and we think we know them well, we think we know how we should pray. You know, Lord, I just pray for, I always use Johnny. Johnny moved, so I got to find somebody else. Lord, I pray for JC. Lord, straighten JC out. Father God, help him. Sometimes he can be such a knucklehead. Lord, not JC's never a knucklehead. Is he Erica? He's never a knucklehead. She didn't answer. But you know, you can, when you're having trouble with somebody, you can put your own self into it. And what is that? That's just not valuable for anybody. And you don't want to pray that way. So when you pray the Word, it takes you out of it. Because you think you know what they need to do, but you probably don't, because you don't even know what you... Isn't that funny? We think we know what everybody else ought to do, but you can't even figure your own self out. You don't even know what you're supposed to do. How can you get everybody else's life all figured out? You can't. And so pray the Word takes you out of it. Praying in the Holy Ghost takes you out of it. And you'll be surprised sometimes. If you ever heard me pray, sometimes I'll be praying some things out and I'll be like, well, Lord, that don't make any sense. Because you know, you already think you know. Well, I don't know why I'd do that. I want to see, if you learn how to do this, you can learn how to have a conversation with God that'll amuse you sometimes. And I don't mean that in a light, frothy way. It's just, it becomes very real and very fluid. And sometimes when you pray stuff out, it will surprise you. And when you pray for people, some things you get will surprise you. Sometimes when you think they need a fly swatter, God's going to give, you know, y'all know what that is, a paddle. God will give them a hug. And you think they need a hug, and he'll tell them to straighten up. He knows what we need. And so in prayer, you're not manipulating people and you're not manipulating God. You're making something available in the realm of the Spirit for God to move and work. All right? Prayers are very powerful. Revelations chapter 5, verse 8 talks about the golden vials full of prayers, an odor that comes up before the saints. You remember we looked at this in Acts chapter 10. Remember Cornelius, the guy who started the Gentile church, which you and I are a part of, most of us in this room, almost all of us, unless you're of Jewish descent, natural Jewish descent. What happened? He prayed, and the Bible says his prayers went up for a memorial. What was that? Golden, those vials. It went up before the Lord. Your prayers, sometimes you kabota nambrofe seheme. Okay. Zabroste bragata sovrete, shiknahai, fostene. Sometimes you think so natural. You think I haven't answered you, but your prayers are ever before me. And in their due season, they will be responded to. Y'all stand. Tell you one more thing as we're getting ready. I wanted to pray a lot longer. We'll just see. If you have to slip out, you can, as we get going. But please stay for a little bit and pray with us. Remember Daniel? Daniel in the Bible, the Old Testament Daniel. Remember what happened? He read a prophecy by Jeremiah. And they were supposed to be leaving. The time of the captivity was over. And the Bible says he set himself to know. And that is part of praying in the Holy Ghost, praying out mysteries, praying out the future, is you come with the determination, I've set myself to know something. Something, I sense something, I need to know something. I set myself to know. And the Bible says the moment Daniel set himself to know, heaven responded. Everybody looks at that from the New Testament, and they always get caught up in the war that went on in the heavenlies between the archangel and the prince of Persia. But listen, let me just say to this. We live in a new covenant. And I believe Jesus destroyed all principalities and powers and might and dominion. I don't believe there's any hesitation anymore to get you what you need. Because you're seated above that. You're seated above that. You're seated above that. That's where the wrong teaching in prayer came, is we got to pull down strongholds. We got to pull down demons that live over cities. You know, where, you know, birds of a feather flock together and they sometimes bring demons with them. But those things don't have to get off on you and those things don't have to dictate. Because you're seated above them. But what you and I should get from that is the moment he began to pray, an angel was dispatched because he set himself to know. We live in a season where you and I need to know.